Imagine you want to get really good at cornhole. Only in this version of cornhole, the hole is only 3 feet away from where you're standing. Would you choose option one, which is to practice at a distance of 3 feet for, say, a week? Or would you choose option two, which is to practice both at 2 feet and at 4 feet, but never at 3 feet? Now, keep in mind that the test or the contest is at 3 feet distance. I'll give you a minute to think about what you would do in this situation. You want to take the 3 feet distance. Okay? Yeah, that makes sense, seeing as how the actual contest involves throwing at 3 feet. In a classic study, researchers asked one group of students to practice throwing beanbags at 3 feet away from the hole. And then they asked another group of students to practice throwing the beanbag at 2 feet and at 4 feet away, but never at 3 feet. And then they tested all the students by asking them to throw at the 3 feet distance. Before I tell you what happened, I want to clarify our intuition here, because it really seems like the students who throw at 3 feet, who have actually gotten practice throwing at the correct distance, would be the group to win the contest. They would outperform the group who just threw at 2 and 4 feet. But the opposite happened. It's actually the group that threw at 2 and 4 feet that beat the group that threw at 3 feet. Why? Well, after 40 years or so of research findings like these, there's still a lot that we don't know about why this works. But a couple of things seem pretty clear. One is that variation is good. It works for motor skills, it works for verbal skills, it works for problem-solving skills. In almost any scenario that we want to train for, usually variation in training helps our long-term learning. The group that varies their practice almost invariably, did I say that? Really? The group that varies their practice almost always outperforms the group that doesn't. You might consider just a hypothetical, like what if we added an extra group that only threw at 2 feet? So we've got a group that throws at 2 feet, that practices at 2 feet, we've got a group that practices at 3 feet, we've got a group that practices at 2 and 4 feet. Well, if we added this extra group, my prediction of what would happen would be that the group at 2 feet would do the worst. The group at 3 feet would do okay, and the group at 2 and 4 feet would do the best. There's not something special about the distances chosen here. It's not like 2 and 4 feet are special. It's really about that the student is getting exposed to a variety of circumstances. It could be 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 feet if they wanted to, or it could be 5 and 10 feet, or anything. Well, 10 feet might be a little long, I don't know. But the point is that there is variation around the core skill. There's not just, you know, drilling that skill over and over and over again. The second piece of this that kind of relates to the first is about how we think about the skill. So if you think that the skill is, hey, the skill is really about throwing a beanbag from 3 feet away. That's the target skill that we want to go for. If you think that way, then that's not good. That's too narrow. You're kind of defining the skill too narrowly. What you want to be thinking about is almost more like that learning these skills are more like learning templates that can be applied to a variety of situations. So in this case, right, the 2 and the 4 feet, they both involve the same motor skill. They both involve kind of judging the distance. But you might think of the skill less about, you know, throwing it at 3 feet and more about just, you know, throwing a beanbag at any target. So the same principle applies to free throws, by the way. So that's what I'm going to do right now. Like and subscribe for more tidbits like this. I will I'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.